Abacus, small enough to jail, tells the incredible saga of the Chinese immigrant Sung family, owners of Abacus Federal Savings of Chinatown, New York. Accused of mortgage fraud by Manhattan District Attorney Cyrus R. Vance Jr., Abacus becomes the only U.S. bank to face criminal charges in the wake of the 2008 financial crisis. The indictment and subsequent trial forces the Sung family to defend themselves and their bank's legacy in the Chinatown community over the course of a five-year legal battle. Abacus, Small Enough to Fail, is directed by Steve James, whose previous films include the Peabody and Robert F. Kennedy Award-winning Hoop Dreams, Sundance Prize winner Stevie, the Independent Documentary Association award-winning miniseries The New Americans, Tribeca Film Festival grand prize winner The War Tapes, At the Death House Door, winner of numerous festival awards, The Interrupters, which won an Emmy, Independent Spirit Award, and the DuPont Columbia Journalism Award, among others. His most recent film, Life Itself, which chronicled the life and career of film critic Roger Ebert, was named the best documentary of the year by over a dozen critics associations. His other credits include Prefontaine, Real Paradise, No Crossover, The Trial of Allen Iverson, and Head Games. God. And he joins us now. I was going to say, yeah, this is your life. Steve James, this is your life. He joins us now on behalf of Abacus, Small Enough to Jail. Steve, thanks. Welcome. Thank you for being here.
Sure.
Good to be here. Geez, where to begin? I guess with the film's final comment, in fact, with which we began, and one I suspect very few people actually know about, I certainly didn't until I watched your movie, that the Abacus Bank, the Abacus Federal Savings of Chinatown, New York, the 2,651st largest bank in the U.S., whose assets are 1/100 of 1% of Bank America, and who, in your words, are in many ways the mirror opposite of the big banks, was the only U.S. bank indicted for mortgage fraud related to the 2008 U.S. mortgage crisis. That's really what your film is about, right? But that was astonishing to me to realize that.
Yeah, it was astonishing to me too. And it, on top of all of that, it was a story until we made this film that was seriously underreported in the mainstream media. I think one of the, in some ways, one of the pleasures of watching the film is that when people come to the film, they have no idea how this is going to turn out because they didn't know anything about it. And I'm not going to tell
your, yeah, I was wrestling with that, but since you said let's not go there. Yeah.
Let's not. Okay. But I think that it was this story that took place in the backyard of the New York Times, even in Chinatown, right. New York, and they even only devoted two articles to it. The indictment, where the defendants were paraded down the hall in chains, which was quite a spectacle, and then the decision, which came 3 years later. So yeah, it is an amazing story, and it's an amazingly important story, I think, that I think we were really fortunate to be able to tell.
At what point did you decide to document the story, and how did its evolution alter your original concept? Did you have an original concept, or did just the unfolding of events dictate it?
What happened is that a colleague of mine that I've worked with in various ways in the past, including he was a executive producer on Life Itself, he knew the Sung family. He was good friends with Vera Sung, and going back like 10 years, that's how he found out about it. They were telling him, like, we're being forced to go through this crazy trial now. And Mark Mitten is the producer's name. And so Mark reached out to me and said, there's this crazy story happening with this family that I know. And he started to tell me about it. And that's what led to the genesis for making the film. And so we didn't really enter. We entered the process of making the film at the trial. That's when I found out about it. I mean, they were indicted back in 2012, but it didn't come to trial until 2015.
Right. Why do you think it was so underreported?
I really don't have a good explanation for that. I mean, I think that that maybe there was this sense that it wasn't a significant trial. Because it is a trial for, even though it has there were a lot of counts brought against Abacus, they were all of a very petty variety. I mean, nothing, on the order of what the big banks, you know, engaged in back then. So I think the pettiness of the charges themselves, no matter how many of them were brought against the bank, contributed to it. I think the size of the bank, as you said, the 2,651st largest bank, you know, they were just kind of a blip on the radar. And I think that perhaps the media didn't focus on the fact that the sort of profound irony of the fact that of all the banks to be criminally indicted, this became the sort of poster child for the mortgage crisis, at least in the eyes of Cyrus Vance Jr., the DA of New York, who brought the case.
And there seemed to be, from watching the movie, this unrelenting energy on the part of the DA's office to really, like, you know, get to the bottom of this and you know, bring this bank, which was accused of what, larceny and fraud and all that, to justice. I mean, it's that energy seemed to me very misplaced based on what their argument was, which seemed, when you looked at it just objectively, logically, it seemed kind of flimsy.
Yeah, I mean, really, you know, the fact that fraud was taking place among some loan officers was never in dispute. It was the bank, as you learn in the film, that discovered the fraud. It was the bank that then fired that employee.
Right.
And then initiated their own internal investigation, which resulted in releasing some other employees. And then, of course, they also reported it to their regulators, which was their duty. And then when the DA's office entered the case, they thought originally that the DA's office was there to actually help them root out any remaining, you know, persons who might be engaged in, you know, doing fraudulent loans. It wasn't until it moved along that they suddenly realized that they were the target, that the DA's office is going to bring charges saying that the bank was complicit and directed its loan officers to engage in this kind of fraud. And so on the face of it, it never seemed to make sense unless it was some kind of crazy, twisted Law and Order episode or something, you know?
Or just some other agenda that, for whatever reason, is unspoken.
That's what takes you to what right. might have been the other agenda, which is, I think it is certainly, you know, Cyrus Vance is in the movie and he denies this, but you know, I think you can certainly make a strong case that he saw this as a grand opportunity to be the prosecutor who brought criminal charges against a bank in the wake of the mortgage crisis. You know, he wouldn't have been able to do that at the federal level with the big banks because the feds controlled that. This is in his backyard.
Too big to fail, right?
Too big to fail. So he was a bank he could go after. And as he made clear in his press conference when he announced the indictments, that this was the first bank indictment since 1991. I mean, he really, you know, sort of grandstand on it. And of course, there was the parading of the defendants down the hall, literally chained together as if they were, hardened criminals instead of loan officers who may or may not have engaged in some minor fraud.
Right, yeah. And the DA, this is purely subjective, but the DA's vibe to me was distinctly one of condescension and smugness and elitism. I mean, that's what I read into it. And I guess I know it's the prosecutor's job in a trial to prosecute, but it almost seemed that Cyrus Vance Jr. we're talking about, he was the DA in New York City, and his office were assuming guilty unless proven innocent. That was the vibe to me that seemed to be all through the narrative of the movie.
Yeah, and I think that I think there was probably a belief by his office that the bank would never go to trial, that they would ultimately strike a deal and avoid trial because of how expensive it was. And in that, and if that was their assumption, which I think is arguably true, they seriously underestimated the Sungs, because the Sungs were not willing to make a deal. And they had the wherewithal, even though they're the 2,651st largest bank in the United States, they had the wherewithal and the ability to spend the money to defend themselves, and that's, you know, what they decided to do.
What, 5 years? $10 million?
It was a five-year ordeal from the standpoint of when The incident happened in 2009. In 2010, that's when the Sungs, it became clear to them that they were now the focus of the indictment. Then in 2012, the indictment came down and it went to trial in 2015. And it was a very long trial. It ran like 70 some days. I mean, the Boston, you know, marathon murder trial was came and went in the time that this trial. Anyway, yeah, so it ended up costing the Sungs $10 million to defend themselves.
In your opinion, do you think, I know we're getting into slippery territory here, but do you think that this was a veiled attack on the Chinese community? Because it seemed that way to me.
Yeah, I don't, you know, we try to be careful about that in the movie.
You're
I mean,
very objective.
We didn't, yeah. I always believe it's really important to let the viewer wrestle with some of these kinds of questions instead of, getting polemical over it. I don't know, I don't know what was in the heart of Cyrus Vance when it came to this in terms of his feelings about the Chinese community. I think it's very possibly true that it wasn't in any way targeted at the Chinese, but that he saw a bank that he thought was guilty enough to bring to trial. I'm not sure, but I would guess in some way what went into that equation is that the Chinese community of New York and many places, is my understanding, are not particularly politically powerful or engaged, and there's reasons for this, right?
Yeah.
And so he was dealing with a constituency that was less threatening, no matter how this went, for him as an elected official. You know, again, whether that went into his calculation or not, I don't know, but it's true.
Well, it's interesting because that's one of the things that's pointed out in the movie, is that culturally too, the Chinese tend to be a little more acquiescent towards law and
power.
Order or power or state. Authority.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And it comes, most of the people who live in Chinatown come from mainland China. And so they have a certain kind of experience with state power that colors the way in which they deal with politics here. And it's one of the things that, one of the things that the Sungs talk about, and there's an activist in the film named Don Lee,
yep,
speaks to, is that there's a strong belief that among some in the community that they need to become more politically empowered, that they cannot accept political disenfranchisement to the degree that they have to now.
That's a metaphor for the whole country right now, I think.
True.
We're talking to Steve James. He's the director of Abacus, Small Enough to Jail. How was the jury selected? I mean, were there any Chinese jurors on the... I mean, I know how the jury was selected, how a jury is selected, but that occurred to me too while I was watching the movie. It's like, well...
No, there weren't.
Yeah.
We weren't around for jury selection, but, if you watch enough TV, you kind of know.
Yeah.
It's sort of like that becomes a very significant phase of any trial, right, as to who gets selected and who gets rejected by both sides. But no, there weren't any Chinese or Asians on the jury at all.
What do you think of banks in general? this notion, I loved that I actually saw this articulated in a movie, in a real life story, this notion of taking your deposits, but not giving you a loan. Because I've experienced that before too. Uh-huh. I remember, I think Harry Truman famously said once, he was talking about banks, and he goes, well, there's a bunch of crooks for you. They're happy to loan you money when you can prove you don't need it. And then he went on to say, if you want a friend in this life, get a dog. But that was the joke. But I'm curious. Can you respond to that at all?
Well, I belong to a community bank where I live. And I love the bank. It's like my little local bank. And when mm-hmm. I go in, no, it's not like all the tellers know me or anything, The commitment to the community is felt strongly. The service to community is felt strongly, and they are engaged in what I think we always thought banks were really about, which was you know, engaged in supporting and building up a local community and helping people, you know, climb up the ladder towards their dreams. And that's what the Abacus Bank has been since 1985 in the Chinatown community. It fulfilled a need that Mr. Thomas Sung saw that was needed to lend to, not just take the deposits of Chinese citizens and residents in the community, but also lend the money. He saw a need and stepped in to serve it. And, you know, the big banks, are not engaged in that. I mean, that's not, you know, that's not how they measure their success. Is did they give, you know, Joe Smith a loan down the street so he could expand on his restaurant? You know, that's there. It's just a different metric at work there.
Well, you made the key distinction here. You said community bank,
yeah,
and that's key. Let me get your opinion of the government bailout of the banks and the notion that indicting them could wreck the entire financial system.
Well,
because you know what always infuriated me was that the banks who admitted to these crimes, right, as somebody says in the movie,
right,
and they were accused of even worse, you know, God, and God knows what we don't know, were not only never indicted or their behaviors called into question, but even after the fact, they still benefited financially, and it was that the customers, the people who kept these operations afloat and profitable, they were never given that same courtesy. They still had to pay their credit card debt.
Yes. Yeah, no,
that
I mean,
it makes me insane. Crazy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm with you on this. And it's like, you know, I think that the notion that they were too big to fail needed to be challenged more than it was. And, you know, Neil Borofsky, who is a real voice of reason in the film, you know, who headed up the TARP program.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, he's a great sort of informed voice of reason, I think, in our film. And, you know, this isn't in the film particularly, but he talked about us during the interview that we did with him about how this notion that they were too big to fail was really flawed in his view. And that's precisely what needed to happen, was to break up the big banks. Instead, we bailed them out.
If you believe what you read, it's all happening again.
And right, it seems like it's cycling back around again.
Yeah. Was the DA's office eager to appear on camera?
No. It was a real struggle to get anybody from the prosecution side to be in this film, but we were dogged, and I have to give real credit to co-producer Nick Verbitsky, who came on board when Frontline came into this project late in the process, but one of the key contributions they made was to bring to us Nick Verbitsky. And Nick was like a bulldog, and he really, you know, we had been trying all along to get the prosecution in and failed, and Nick just was one of those guys who didn't take no for an answer. He first got Polly Greenberg, who was head of economic crimes at the time of the trial, and that was a key get for us to get her in, and I give her great credit for being the first to be willing to come forward and speak candidly about the trial. And then once we, you know, again, without giving away the decision here, but the
I think we're doing really good because
that's right.
I wish we could talk about the decision.
But the deliberations went on for quite a while.
Yeah.
And at that point, we realized we really need to get jurors in this as well. And we were able to get a good representation of the differing views on the part of the jury into it. And all of these things, I think, paved the way for ultimately getting Cyrus Vance Jr. And I think what also helped was at that point we had the imprimatur of Frontline behind us.
Yeah.
That didn't hurt.
Yeah.
And I really greatly appreciate the fact that Mr. Vance did the interview. I think we tried our best to keep his thoughts and beliefs intact in the film. So that
and he seemed very forthcoming.
And very forthcoming, yeah. You know. So I give him great credit for speaking candidly.
We only have a few minutes here. How has the climate for the making of documentaries since you made Hoop Dreams, for example, changed? If indeed it has, how is it different?
Well, I mean, it's changed a lot. I mean, there's a lot of things that have changed. I mean, first of all, when I made Hoop Dreams, there wasn't this sense that, strongly felt sense that maybe one could make documentaries for a living. I mean, there were examples out there. There were the Frederick Wisemans.
But they were the exceptions.
Yeah, there were the Barbara Copples, who seemed to be finding a way to do it, the Maisels. Yeah. But, like, that was about it. I'm not sure there was anybody else,
I think,
right?
You covered it, yeah.
That might have been it. Yeah. And I'm not even sure how good of a living they were making. So it was like you didn't think of documentary as a career path. You thought of it as something you just wanted to do, and you'll figure out what you do otherwise. And that's changed. I think there's a lot of, which I think is very exciting, there are a lot of young filmmakers over the last 10, 20 years who have gone into documentary because they see it as their, as an art form that is fully satisfying to them, that they're not looking at as a stepping stone to something else, that they, and I think that, you know, what used to be considered a kind of the documentary genre is kind of ridiculous to think of it as a genre. The documentary includes every genre that, you know,
right,
that is known to fiction filmmaking.
Do you think
at this point,
do you think the commercialization of the documentary genre has helped it?
I think that it has largely helped it in the sense that it has opened up more opportunities. It has attracted more filmmakers that otherwise would have chosen a different path, and we have benefited from their artistry. Yes, I think for the most part it has helped. I think that there are times when certain documentaries might feel a little too commercialized, and you feel like maybe a little bit of the sort of integrity of documentary is, you know, not what you'd want it to be. But I'm not a curmudgeon about any of it. I think that we really truly are, as many people have said, we are living in a kind of golden age of documentary where the most innovative films being made year in and year out, and the most captivating and compelling are happening in the documentary genre.
Yeah. Okay, I have a last question. It's kind of a big question, but what do you think your film says about the larger issues of justice in America? And is your film telling us anything new?
Well, I think it depends on who you are as to whether it's telling you anything new. I mean, there are whole swaths of our country and communities in our country where what happens to the Sungs can seem like the par for the course, that the justice system is not about meting out true justice, and that, you know, as Matt Taibbi, who we interviewed in the film, would tell you, is that
it was great that you got him in there. I always like seeing him.
Yeah, he's that you know, we have a problem with the unequal application of justice in this country. Something like 97% of the cases brought end up in plea bargains. And I don't think it's because 97% of the people were guilty. I think it's because most people, and if you're a poor person in particular, and the Sungs aren't poor, thank God, but if you're a poor person and you're faced with the might of the state coming down on you, you have to make a calculation as to whether you're going to fight for your innocence or whether you're going to plead. And a lot of times what people don't understand, unless they've been in that situation, is that if you're innocent and you plead guilty to a crime, you're not done with it, even if you don't do time. It will follow you around and impact your life. So, yeah, there are a lot of people in this country for whom a film like this isn't telling them anything they don't already know. But there are a lot of us, I think, that we are unaware because we're insulated from that, from the legal system in a way that we don't understand just how unequal the application of justice can be.
The film is Abacus, Small Enough to Jail. Its director, Steve James, has been our guest. Thank you, Steve, for being with us and for your time.
Thank you.